Little skeletons, it is Disney Queen Skelly here, and welcome back to another top 5 video. So today are my top 5 favorite villains. So without further ado, let's get into it. My 5th favorite villain is Maleficent. Maleficent is an evil fairy and the main antagonist of Disney's 1959 animated feature film Sleeping Beauty. Maleficent is an incarnation of pure evil and responsible for all misfortune in King Stefan's kingdom. She takes offense at not being invited to the christening of Princess Aurora and attempts revenge on King Stefan and Queen by cursing Aurora. She appears to be particularly disdainful of the three good fairies, Flora, Fauna, and Meriwether, her polar opposites, who do all in their power to keep Maleficent's overwhelming evil magic at bay. She is frequently accompanied by her pet raven, Diablo. With her dark, elegant design, dramatic and flamboyant animation, and unlimited arsenal of magic powers at her command, Maleficent is one of the most popular and recognizable Disney villains, in addition to being one of the primary members of the official franchise. Maleficent is a badass bitch. Now, I will admit, in making this top 5 list, I didn't have that many villains I could actually put on the list. And the only reason why is because I never really thought about who my favorite villains were. And in thinking about it, my favorite Disney princess is Aurora. So I figure, why not kind of give Maleficent a little bit of a spotlight on this list? She is a badass bitch. She definitely doesn't take shit from anybody. And her defeat was absolutely iconic. And granted, I do prefer my princess, but I will give Maleficent credit for being one of the most amazing Disney villains out there. And I gotta admit, she is pretty good looking. I can see why hubby has a little bit of a thing for her. But my 4th favorite villain is Hades. About him. Overview. The flamboyant lord of the underworld. While his fellow Greek gods get to live in the lap of luxury on Mount Olympus, Hades spends his days managing the dead in the dark and dingy underworld. Bitter and frustrated, Hades plots to steal power from his brother Zeus by using a rare planetary alignment to his advantage. Personality. Charming, manipulative, and quick to anger, Hades is the ultimate charismatic showman. Although when things don't go his way, he has trouble keeping his anger in check. Mostly, however, he has manipulation and persuasion to get other people to do his dirty work for him. Don't let his personable sense of humor fool you. Hades is one of the most ruthless villains out there. Now, for those of you who know me very well, it may come as a shock to you that Hades is number 4. So Hades is at number 4 because it actually is a villain I like a little bit better than him, even though Hades has been talked about a lot on my channel. Hades is my all-time favorite Disney villain, and the reason why is because he is just as ruthless as Maleficent. He wants to take a child's life, which is nuts. I mean, the fates told him, like, hey, if you don't kill Hercules, your plan ain't gonna work. So he's like, shit, I'll go kill a freaking baby. And he does that because he wants to rule all of Olympus and all of everything, while Maleficent was just like, you didn't invite me to your birthday party? Bitch, you did. But anyway, Hades is ruthless. He's, manipulative. He is an overall badass villain, and the reason why he's my absolute favorite is because he is sarcastic, but he's also an asshole, and that personality is just, something I am drawn towards. So Hades, you are number 4. But that doesn't mean you still don't have a very special place in my heart. My 3rd favorite villain is, I don't think he actually considers himself a villain, but you make that choice. John Kramer. The Saw franchise's main villain is the Jigsaw Killer, but it took several tragic events to turn John Kramer into the monster he ultimately became. Of course, John never thought of himself as a monster or a boogeyman. In fact, he frowned upon the name the Jigsaw Killer, as he, like many great villains, thought of what he was doing as a righteous and noble pursuit. John merely thought his targets had stopped being grateful for the gift of life, and wanted to push them to fight for it. In practice, that definitely doesn't make John not a killer. His games are still essentially orchestrated murders, no matter what the man himself believed. Putting someone in the position to meet a gruesome demise with their only escape being self-mutilation is murder in just about any book if that person indeed dies. If they don't die, well, there's still dozens of crimes that perpetrator has committed. Considering Jigsaw was dying of cancer, though, he was probably never afraid. After all, what were they going to do, kill him? John Kramer wasn't always so many unethical, though. At one point, he was a kind, decent man with a loving wife and child on the way. Then everything went wrong. For John, Murphy's Law was in full effect. As revealed in Saw 4, John Kramer was once a respected civil engineer and property developer with a wife named Jill Tucker, who ran a clinic for drug addicts. The clinic's motto was "Cherish Your Life," but patient Cecil Adams failed to do that one night as his forced entry and exit to steal drugs led to the tragic miscarriage of Jill and John's unborn son, Gideon. Naturally, this devastated the couple, and neither their marriage or John was ever the same afterward. John and Jill got divorced, and not long after, John found out he was dying of cancer and there was nothing to be done to save him. John's once charmed life again had gone to hell, and the future Jigsaw decided to end things by committing suicide, as seen in Saw 2. However, he survived the attempt, and that survival made him realize that despite everything, he was lucky to be alive and needed to appreciate that. So John became Jigsaw, using his remaining time on Earth to make others realize how much they were wasting their lives and test their will to survive. His first test subject was naturally Cecil, who failed the test, arguably getting what he deserved, having gone unpunished for his crimes. Now, as sick as it may sound, I actually kind of agree with John Kramer, the character in Saw. I don't believe he was a murderer, because he's the one, well, he set up most of these traps to be survivable, unlike some of his descendants who didn't, but we won't get into that. He made these traps to be survivable and livable. And as proved by many, many, many traps, people do survive them. And I feel like it does give them a better sense of life in that when there's one scene in the movies when there's a support group of all of the survivors and they don't come out the same. They never do. And of course, it's a traumatic event. You put someone's life on the line and, you know, they end up either mutilated or they survive and it's like, wow, what the hell just happened? And I mean, I will admit, Amanda is one of the exceptions in that things didn't exactly turn out well for her even after she got out of the trap. But nonetheless, I think that the idea of John Kramer in that and what his backstory is and why he designs the traps and the traps that he designs is absolutely remarkable. Because you can get these villains who have their stories, like someone died or they're dying or, you know, something happened in their lives that just made such a traumatic experience for them. And then they take that and then they run with it and they create something so catastrophic and ugly that no one can really stop them. And, you know, that happens a lot in, like, comic books and superhero movies. But when you have something like Saw where the villain died and there was many more after him, and, you know, you could never really see the next one coming. It was absolutely incredible. You know, John Kramer kept getting away with it even after death. And I think that's really fucking incredible. Not to say that I'm, like, anywhere near support of murder. But the way that it was portrayed in Saw is absolutely insane. And that's all I really have to say about it before we get too far. So my second favorite villain is Oogie Boogie. Unlike most of the residents of Halloween Town who scare people for entertainment, Oogie is truly evil. Because of that, he is exiled from the town and lives somewhere far away. His only companions are Lock, Shock, and Barrel. Upon hearing about Santa Claus, Oogie orders his minions to get him. He introduces himself to Santa and sings his song. While he is torturing him, Oogie is distracted by Sally's leg. Upon finding out that it is a trick and sees Sally trying to free Santa, he captures him. Just as Oogie is about to stop Sally and Santa to drop Sally and Santa into his stew, he finds Jack still alive after the military almost killed him for impersonating him. When Jack appears, Oogie appears to be afraid of him and sets his contraptions on him. While fighting, Oogie jumps into a chandelier where Jack rips the seam, causing all of Oogie's bugs to be killed in a stew. The last bug is crushed by Santa. Now, I think it goes without saying that Oogie is at number 2 because he is from The Nightmare Before Christmas. Now, I know you can have a favorite movie and maybe not like all the characters, because I personally don't like Sally, but I have my own reasons for that. Oogie is definitely a very powerful villain, even though he may seem kind of goofy. And I also think that one of the reasons why I like him is because when I went to go see the 4D experience, there was a bunch of lights and, like, revolving shit when the casino scene happened, and I thought that looked really awesome. But other than that, Oogie is my number 2 favorite villain. because he is so, he's ruthless as well. He doesn't really care, and he'll kill anyone just to get his way. And, you know, he doesn't really have any rhyme or reason for, I guess, being the way he is, because in watching the movie, I never really saw a reason why he was as villainous as he was. But he's still pretty badass. But he's not my top one favorite villain. Top one favorite villain, he's not my top favorite villain. Wow, I can't speak today. My top favorite villain of all time is Loki, god of mischief and brother to Thor. Loki's tricks and schemes wreak havoc across the realms. Loki, prince of Asgard, Odinson, rightful heir of Jotunheim, and god of mischief, is burdened with glorious purpose. His desire to be a king drives him to sow chaos in Asgard. In his lust for power, he extends his reach to Earth. Now, I'll be honest, I think the only reason I put Loki as number one is because, oh my god, I have a huge, huge lady boner for Tom Hiddleston. And I will say, I think that lady boner went down a lot after watching Crimson Peak. I was like, ew. But anyway, yes, Loki is one of my, is my all-time favorite villain. And I mean, it's only appropriate that I'm wearing green and black today, right? There was one time hubby and I went to Disneyland. I think it was for our 9-month anniversary. And to be honest, I don't remember why we went for our 9-month anniversary. But we met Loki in DCA, and like the dressed up, you know, Disney character. And I like curtsied to him. He goes, "Ah, curtsying to the rightful heir of Asgard, are you?" I was like, "Yes." I totally sucked up to him right then and there. And I will say, even though Loki's my favorite, you know, villain of all time, I find it hilarious because Harley Baby's favorite hero is Thor. And if we were to ever meet the two of them, I think we have before, but I think if we were to ever do it again, she'd run directly to Thor, I'd run directly to Loki. And it'd be super fucking hilarious. But anyways, I thank y'all so much for watching today's video. I'll see you tomorrow, and have a great day. Bye, little skeletons. Stay safe. I love you guys. If you have any favorite villains for yourself, let me know in the comment section down below.